spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died.
I'm excited about coming to the Fellowship Baptist Church in Vienna, West Virginia, coming up November 13th and 14th for a Striving Together conference. I want to thank the church family and pastors from the area for supporting this meeting. What is Striving Together conference? Well, Philippians 1:27 admonishes us with one mind and one spirit to strive together for one faith. And so our heart is to gather pastors and Christian workers, irrespective of the Bible college they attended or their background, people of like mind and like faith, to come together for the purpose of encouragement and equipping around the gospel ministry and soul winning. And we want to encourage you if you feel that God could use you in a greater way or you need a word of encouragement in the work of the Lord to join with us for these few days. We'll begin on Monday night with preaching. I look forward to bringing the Bible message. Tuesday morning, we'll be bringing sessions on how to develop leaders in the church, how to organize the soul winning and discipleship of the church. The preaching will include myself and Dr. Jim Shetler. We're looking forward to joining together and being an encouragement. Also joining us will be other teachers who have served here at Lancaster Baptist Church and West Coast Baptist College, just sharing and equipping and encouraging one another at the Striving Together Conference coming up right here in West Virginia. Looking forward to a great time, November 13th and 14th. Let's strive together for the faith of the gospel in this needy hour. If you have more questions, you can certainly call the Fellowship Baptist Church or call us here at Lancaster Baptist Church and ask for Bethany Powell. We'll be glad to give you information. We look forward to meeting you and growing together in Christ at this great conference.
Amen. Let's grab our Bibles out, if you would, to Acts chapter number 3. We're continuing our series through this book of Scripture. We've entitled this series, Victorious Church. And I'm so glad for the victory that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the foundation of the church. He is the cornerstone of all that we do. He said, "On this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." We understand that we are founded on victory. We've been looking at this early church, and we've been seeing how Jesus has been giving them victory. And today, we're going to be taking a look at a victorious glory, a victorious glory. Acts chapter number 3, we're going to begin reading where we left off last week in verse number 12. Before we do, I want to just build out the context for where we're at here in this chapter of Scripture. Last week, we studied the fact that this lame man had been healed. He'd been withered for a long time, unable to walk. He was begging for alms at the beautiful gate. And people were accustomed to walking past him and giving him alms and just really understanding that this man was incapable in and of himself. And Peter looked at him and said, "Look at us." And he said, "In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." How many of you are glad this morning that there is power in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ? And he grabbed the lame man by the right hand and he picked him up. And immediately this lame man's feet and ankles were made whole. He received strength in them again. And he went into the temple walking and leaping and praising God. We see here a transition taking place in this transitional book of Acts where they typically went into the temple in a very transactionary way. That was their relationship with God. They brought their sacrifice. They met out the decrees of the law, and they left untransformed and unchanged. But in the name of Jesus, this man was healed, and because he was utterly and completely transformed, he showed it in his demeanor, and he was walking, and he was leaping, and he was praising God, and he was the one in that temple that was truly worshiping that day. And everybody observed it and saw it, and because of this man's healing, it was now drawing a crowd. People want to see stuff like that. How many, if you were there, you'd have tried to get in line for that too? And a lot of people are coming around to watch this, and this is where we pick up the scripture here in verse number 12. We're going to see Peter's response to this. We're going to see the preparation for the preaching that takes place. And we're going to look at the message that preacher preached to these people that were there. Acts 3, verse number 12, if you found your place there and you're physically able to stand, let's stand together out of respect for the reading of God's word. Notice with me, if you would, verse 12. And when Peter saw it, saw what? Saw the people gathering, saw them wondering, saw them in amazement. Notice what he said. He answered unto the people, "Ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we had made this man to walk? The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, hath glorified his son Jesus, whom ye delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate, when he was determined to let him go. But ye denied the Holy One and the just, and desired a murderer to be granted unto you, and killed the Prince of Life, whom God hath raised from the dead, whereof we are witnesses. And his name, through faith in his name, hath made this man strong, whom ye see and know. Yea, the faith which is by him hath given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. And now, brethren, I wot that through ignorance ye did it, as did also your rulers. But those things which God before had shown by his mouth of all his prophets, that Christ should suffer, he hath so fulfilled. Repent ye therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. And he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you, whom the heaven must receive until the times of restitution of all things, which God hath spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. For Moses truly said unto the fathers, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brother and like unto me, him shall ye hear in all things whatsoever he shall say unto you. And it shall come to pass that every soul which will not hear that prophet shall be destroyed from among the people. Yea, and all the prophets from Samuel and those that follow after, as many as have spoken, have likewise foretold of these days. Ye are the children of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying unto Abraham, and in thy seed shall all the kindreds of the earth be blessed. Unto you first, God, having raised up his son Jesus, sent him to bless you in turning away every one of you from his iniquities. The powerful message Peter preaches here, and we're going to dig into it this morning. We're going to learn about the true glory of God. So let's pray and ask the Holy Spirit to help us this morning. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful to be here, to gather together as your people, to hear your word, to follow the leading of your Spirit unto all truth. And I pray this morning that for a moment we would push aside, Lord, our position, our self-glory, our self-righteousness, and our opportunities to gain glory for ourselves, and that we would lift you up and see you in your glory, that we might be transformed into your image. Help us with that this morning, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Again this morning, we're going to be looking at a victorious glory, a victorious glory. And as we look at that from this passage, I want us to see, first of all, the object of glory. What is the object of glory? We see it firmly on display in how Peter approaches the crowd that has come to see him and what has taken place with this lame man. Attention has been drawn. People have gathered. People are excited. And they've come to look at Peter and John and these disciples and what was going on. And notice how Peter handles this. Verse number 12, and when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we had made this man to walk? Now, Peter has an opportunity here. Peter has an opportunity to gain glory for himself. And oh, how tempting that is. It is a tempting thing to want people to look at us. It is a tempting thing for us to want to have attention for ourselves. I remember in high school playing basketball, there was this one team that always beat us every single year. And this year was going to be our year. We had the team, we had the people, we had the plan, we poisoned their water, you know. We were going to win. And I remember us taking the basketball court and beginning, and things were going well. We got to halftime, we were ahead by about 5 points, and we thought we had them pretty well in hand. We took the court in that second half, and about a minute into that second half, I dribbled through the lane, I passed the guy who was guarding me, I went up for a shot, and when I went up for the shot, the guy behind me swatted the ball out of my hand, but he swatted it up towards the basket, and the ball hit the backboard and went in. And everybody thought it was awesome, and I thought it was awesome, and man, I was running down the court like, yeah! Look what I did. You know how you do. Yeah. And my other teammates were coming over to me, and they were like, can you believe it? And we were so distracted by celebrating something I didn't even do. That we didn't see them making their way down the court. And by the time we saw them do that and we tried to collapse on them with our defense, we fouled them. They made the shot, got to go to the free throw line. It got our coach mad. He said some words. We got a technical foul. They ended up scoring about 6 points off that dumb play. We lost that game. But it's tempting. It's tempting sometimes for things we don't even do to seek out recognition and glory and praise. We want the attention. And this was an opportunity for Peter. Boy, he could have talked about how faithful he was, and he could have shown himself to be strong in his own flesh, and he could have promoted himself, you know, Peter's ministry international. Just plant a seed, right? Just sow a seed of money and help my ministry out. He could have taken over all the glory that really needed to be attributed to the name of Jesus. You know, we have that opportunity every day that we walk in the power of the Spirit of the Lord. We have the opportunity to either glorify ourselves or glorify the one, the name above all names, the Lord Jesus Christ. What are we taking advantage of in our life with the power of the Spirit? Are we leveraging his power in our life to gain attention for ourselves, or are we leveraging the presence of his Spirit in our life to lift him up so that he might draw men unto himself? Here in verse number 12, Peter says, "Why are you looking at us?" Peter does a wonderful thing here. He deflects the glory. That's what we should do in our life. Hey, how many of you understand you didn't save yourself? Not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saves us. He's washed us. He's made us clean. He died for our sins. He rose again. How many of you are glad he did all the work this morning? And he's the one who deserves the glory. He's the one who deserves the honor. Peter says, "Why are you looking at us?" And notice how he points their attention to Jesus. Verse 13, "And the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, hath glorified his son Jesus." That's who God glorified. Hebrews speaks about this. He said unto his son, "Thou shalt sit on my right hand." Hey, make no mistake about it. Jesus is God. You're not God. I'm not God. We deserve no glory. He gets all of the glory. And what a foundational pivotal point for this early church. When the church could have gained glory for it. So how tempting would that have been for this early church? I mean, think about what these disciples had already been through. The threat of persecution, people rejecting them and scorning them, some of them being kicked out of their families for choosing Jesus as their Savior. And how tempting it would have been to have tried to say, "Hey, let's place ourselves in a spot where we're being noticed, where we're being praised, where we're being accredited with things." But the early church didn't do that. Peter didn't do that. He said, "I want you to know this was Jesus whom God has glorified." Is Jesus glorified in your life? Is he glorified in my life? Is he glorified in our church? Is it Jesus who's seen? The object of glory needs to be Jesus. Notice Peter firmly places the credit for the healing of this man on the Lord Jesus Christ. Drop down to verse number 16 with me. Notice, "And his name," whose name? Jesus, "through faith in his name hath made this man strong." How many of you understand the Bible tells us this? Without him, we can do nothing. It's not us that deserves the glory. It's not us that achieves the glory. It is God who gets the glory. In Isaiah 42:8, the verse is on the screen. Notice what the Lord says. "I am the Lord. That is my name." Wow. That's who I am. I'm the Lord. "And my glory will I not give to another, neither my praise to graven images." It's his glory. He is the Lord. I just want us to think for a moment, ministries, churches, pastors, individuals who rob God of his glory, look who they're robbing. He is the Lord. That is his name. And let me just say something. We can't bear up under the burden of his glory. Notice what happens when we're in the presence of his glory. John the Baptist is written about in John 3. We'll start reading with verse number 30. Notice his response to the glory of beholding the Savior. The Word became flesh. He dwelt among us. We beheld his glory. And notice what happened in John the Baptist's life. He says this, John 3, starting with verse 30, he must increase, but I must decrease. How many of you know that's the proper response to the glory of God? He must increase, I must decrease. Notice as the verses continue, he that cometh from above is above all. He that is of the earth is earthly and speaketh of the earth. He that cometh from heaven is above all. Aren't you glad he's above all this morning? He's above us. He's above our sin. He's above our transgression. He's above our situation. He is the only one who's able because he is above all. As we think of victorious glory, let us consider the object of glory this morning. May we never horn in on God's glory. May we never shove God out of the way of his own glory. He is the Lord. He will not give his glory to another. Peter and his disciples deflected the glory and set up the opportunity to share the power and strength and salvation of Jesus with those who were there. How many opportunities do we lose in truly sharing Jesus with others because we're too busy stealing his glory? Because we're too busy taking credit for that which only he deserves. Secondly, this morning, not only do we see the object of glory, but I want us to see the disruption of glory. The disruption of glory. Peter's sermon is going to completely disrupt the self-glory of the Jews. The Jews were very self-glorious. They had crucified Jesus, and they had done so in justifiable ways in their own mind. They were the good ones. They were the holy ones. They were the law followers. And who's this Jesus guy trying to take our glory from us? Listen, the whole religious system of the day was set up for self-glory. The religious leaders were all about self-glory. They wore the long robes in the marketplace. They wore the phylacteries so that they could be seen for how religious they were. They twisted their faces in gruesome ways to show that they were fasting and praying. The whole system was set up for self-glory. They blew their trumpets when they came in to give alms to the lame man. It was all about self-glory, and that's why they denied the Savior, because he truly embodied the glory of God. He was going to steal their glory away from them. He was going to disrupt their glory. And guess what? That's exactly what has to happen in every single person's life before they can come to the saving knowledge of Christ. They have to have their self-glory disrupted. If our self-glory is not disrupted, we can't get saved. Hey, can I share with you something? Jesus doesn't partner with us in our righteousness. He totally gives us his righteousness. We're not collaborators with Jesus. It's not like, hey, I'm a pretty good person, and Jesus, you did some pretty awesome stuff too, and let's get together. There was a man in John chapter number 3 who tried to do that. His name was Nicodemus. He came to Jesus by night. He said, Master, we know you're a teacher come from God, because look at all the cool stuff you're doing. And he's hoping that Jesus will respond to him in a reciprocal way. Yeah, you're pretty cool too. You're really righteous and holy. Look at your robes. Look at what you do. But Jesus didn't say that to Nicodemus. He said, Nicodemus, except you be born again, you cannot receive the kingdom of God. And how many of you know this morning, we cannot get saved through our own glory. We're not partnering with Jesus. He is everything. He is all that we need. Notice how Peter disrupts the glory of those who crucified the Savior. Notice with me, verse 14, if you would. This is powerful. But ye denied the Holy One. And make no mistake, these Jews knew exactly who Peter was talking about when he said the Holy One. That holy thing is what Jesus was called when Mary was bearing the Savior in her womb. That holy thing, that Holy One, these are terms that identify the Messiah. And Peter is saying, you denied the Holy One. And the just, this is another name for Jesus. He is the just one. And notice the stark contrast here. Notice the distinction between our sinful glory and God's holy glory. We can't even choose correctly in our own self-glory. We can't choose correctly in our own sin. Notice what he says to them here. Verse 14, but ye denied the Holy One and the just and desired a murderer to be granted unto you. What a contrast. You denied the one who came to give you life and you chose the murdering Barabbas. Oh man, that had to cut them to the heart. He laid open before them how inglorious they actually were. They didn't even make the right decision. And how satanic their decision was. Here we have the giver of life and we have a murderer. And they choose the thief and the murderer. The thief cometh not for our good. He cometh to kill and to steal and destroy. But I have come, Jesus has come, that we might have life and that we might have it more abundantly.